Hey guys, before we get started with today's lesson, let me know in the comments below if you find pharmacology to be just overwhelming. I'm expecting a lot of yeses, just so you know. What I get a lot from my students is, how do I remember all the different names of drugs? And the key is, you don't. You learn it by classification, and that's why we're going to talk about one classification of antibiotics today, known as the carbapenems. What's great about learning drugs by classification is that you can then put together pieces of information so that you don't have to memorize a list of drugs. You'll be able to identify them quickly. Now, not all classifications have that additional bonus, but the one we're talking about today, carbapenems, does. So let's get to the board and we'll start the lesson. Welcome back, my name is Tammy and this is NurseMinder, and on this channel we do everything nursing. So if you're new here, consider subscribing below so that you get the next video when it's released.
When it comes to recognizing which drugs are in the carbapenem classification, that's an easy one. They all end in penem, P-E-N-E-M. And so there's no need to memorize a name for the classification of carbapenem, because when you see it in an exam, for example, your patient is on meropenem, you go, ah, that's a carbapenem, and this is what I remember about carbapenems. So the first thing I want you to know is there's a lot of hints in the name. I love me a good name, okay? I think carbs are both good for us because we need them for our cellular function. It's the fuel for our brain, and they are building blocks of steroids, hormones, and so carbs are good for our body. That's the gram positive. Carbs, as you might already have guessed, are also negative for our body. When we eat too much, we gain weight. We become sluggish. So that's how I remember that carbapenem is both for gram positive and gram negative bacteria. But here's something you need to know. Unlike carbs, we consume them through our mouth. We eat. Carbapenems are not given orally, just the opposite. They are given intramuscularly and intravenously. So when you think of carbs, there's another clue in terms of carbapenems. While they are both for gram positive and gram negative, we do not consume them. We have them done parenterally through IM and IV injections. Awesome, right? Okay, let's get back to the board. We have another clue inside the word, and that's the letter P. When it comes to carbapenem, where do they work? They work in the polyribosomal part of the cell. That's your P. And what do? Is they change protein function, it's your second P, in order to prevent cell division. So let me write that out for you. Okay, so here we have it summarized. The site of action is polyribosomes, where it will change protein function in order to prevent cell division. That's a lot of words to say that it inhibits cell division. It creates cell death. But if you need to remember where it works, we've got a clue in the name P, polyribosomes. We know it's protein. We know it's going to prevent cell division. Boom, bam. Okay, so here's a quick visual of how carbapenem can be so easily dissected. So number one, we have the suffix. When you're looking for a generic name that shows up in one of your NCLEX questions, and your patient might be on meropenem, you know right away it's a carbapenem because the ending, the suffix, is the same as the classification. The site of action is the P, so in the polyribosomes where it changes protein function in order to prevent cell division, which results in cell death. Awesome! Now carbs, remember carbs are both good and bad, so it's good on gram positive, gram negative, but despite carbs, how we take them orally, we're actually going to take them intravenously and intramuscularly. They are not an oral medication. In fact, these are used for quite a long time, typically 5 to 14 days, because of the serious infections that we use them for. So let's talk about a few more pieces. Hey guys, if this is making sense to you and this is like light bulb, and you're like, I can remember this, let me know with an emoji below, because learning should be fun. And I really try to bring out the little things, the nuances of a word to help you remember them. So let's get back to the board. Now, because this is a broad spectrum antibiotic, remember gram positive, gram negative, the list is long as to what it will treat. You want to always be checking your culture and sensitivity. Now, it's possible your patient will be started on an antibiotic before we get those results in. And what you'll be looking for then is the patient's response to the treatment. Is the infection getting better? So if it's a skin wound, are you seeing a decreasing, a shrinking of that swelling and redness? Are there changes in their white blood cell count on their lab results? What is it that you're seeing that's actually identifying that this drug is working until we get our culture and sensitivity report back? If you have it, you'll want to check it to make sure that this drug has been identified as something that the infection will respond to. Now, because the list is so long, I wanted to give you one reason why your patient would not be on a carbapenem, and that is MRSA. That is a really common diagnosis that we see, is methicillin-resistant staph aureus. Your patient would not be on a carbapenem. Now, anytime we use antibiotics, we have to be worried about the fact that not only do they wipe out the bad bacteria, but they also wipe out the good bacteria. And when we think of that, we think of our gut. In our stomach, we have a lot of bacteria that are good for us to help protect us. But when we decrease the numbers of those, we're at risk of Clostridium difficile, shortened as C. diff, which is a lot of poo. Okay, so diarrhea is one of the side effects of any antibiotic. Now, this one in particular also has a side effect that you need to be aware of, and that is pseudomembranous colitis. So what happens is we get these inflamed areas of yellow plaque, and it inhibits the ability of the colon to absorb nutrients, and then we end up being dehydrated and have electrolyte imbalances as a result. So when you think of carbs, think of bloated, think of how you feel when you eat too many, and then think about inside your colon and how that is also causing this bloated yellow plaques to start to develop. Now, one really important contraindication, and again, this is coming from our clues in the words. I want to go back to carbs. What happens when you don't have enough carbs? Have you ever felt hangry? Like you're starting to shake and sweat and feel like I've got to have something to eat? I want you to remember that, because one of the most important contraindications is patients who have a history of seizure disorders. It can actually decrease the threshold of seizures, which means it will increase the impact or the volume of seizures that they have, okay? So think carbs when I'm really low and I'm shaky. Connect that to seizures. Don't give them carbapenem, because it's going to actually increase the risk of seizures for them. So with that, I think it's time for our NCLEX question. Okay, as the nurse, you are preparing to administer imipenem cilastatin 500 milligrams IV every 6 hours for septicemia. What lab test would confirm that this is the appropriate medication for this patient? A, a white blood cell count. B, a culture and sensitivity. C, cholesterol levels. D, hemoglobin. Now that you've paused the video and you've come back, if you answered B, culture and sensitivity, you would be correct. It is true that the white blood cell count may be elevated, but that is not a confirmation for the medication. We need to do a culture and sensitivity. Well done. Okay, here a physician writes an order for ertapenem 1 gram daily orally for 10 days. As the nurse reviews this order, what would be the priority action? 1, call the pharmacy to make sure the drug is available. 2, assess the patient to ensure they can swallow pills. 3, call the physician to revise the order for an IM or IV prescription. Or D, assess the patient wound prior to administration to document any changes. Go ahead and pause and make your selection. If you have selected to call the physician to revise the order, you would be correct, because carbapenems are only given intramuscularly, intravenously, and not orally. I just want to share, you have done some great work watching this video and committing those little elements and those tips and tricks to memory, so that when you come up to a question in your nursing exam, you're going to be able to nail it. Well done, you. Now, I really appreciate you watching and supporting this channel. And what I'll ask for you to do next is to subscribe if you haven't already, because subscribing is what helps me continue to feel like there's a need for this content. So I want to make sure that what I'm providing is of value. And if it is of value, that's how you can let me know, is subscribing. You can hit the like button, comment below, and for sure share, because that sometimes is the inspiration I need to continue to do this content. And then, of course, share it. You know what? We're only stronger when we work together, and there's no need to keep this information to yourself. Tag a colleague, let them know that this channel exists, and get them to subscribe as well. Forever grateful.
Have a great day.
Hey, I know you're probably not ready to get off your phone or go back to work just yet, or maybe even turn the lights off to go to sleep. So why don't you spend a little bit more time here watching another video?